Blessed Sunday morning, my brothers and sisters in Christ. Glad to come together with you today. As always, I just encourage everyone, if you can, providentially speaking, God willing, get to church today in accordance with God's word, his commands to tell us, excuse me, God's word that tells us to get together where two or three are gathered. The Lord is with us. And today, as I was going through the thought for the day in Habakkuk chapter 3 and ending this book of the Bible, towards the end of the chapter, Habakkuk chapter 3, verses 16 to 19, speaks about Habakkuk, despite everything he went through in life, specifically verse 17, very difficult hardship times, affliction, he would learn to rejoice in the Lord. And today I wanted to speak about rejoicing during times of affliction in our own lives. Psalm 23, verse 4, King David penned the psalm, "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil." John Wesley was a Christian theologian. He was born in 1703. He died in 1791. And he often would say, "Christian people die well." What he meant by that was that through the sufferings of life and to the point of death, Christians, those who follow Christ, have so much peace in their life that you can see it radiating in their face, even at the point of death. And I've seen that, sadly, this year with the passing of my cousin Annette. She died in April of this year from cancer at the age of 61. And me and my wife would visit her often in the hospital as we saw her demise coming. And yet, she had such peace in her heart. She'd often say, "I'm not afraid to die. I know I'm going to be with Jesus." Contrary to this, Frank Sinatra, who was a very well-known singer, he was born in 1915, died in 1998, had everything that this world had to give. And salvation belongs to the Lord, Jonah 2 verse 9. I'm not judging him, but I don't know if he was saved or not. But I know that at the end of his life, he was preparing to die. It was said by those that saw him ready to die that he was screaming, "I'm losing it, I'm losing it." It reminded me of what Christ said in Matthew chapter 16, verse 26, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, where he said, "What does it profit a man to gain the world and yet forfeit his soul?" My friends, as Christians, we should be willing to suffer just a short period of time here on earth to inherit the eternal life that we have with the Lord. Many people, the vast majority of people, will die unsaved, sadly, because they live for this world. But we will suffer as Christians, and I oftentimes get irked when I see these Christian leaders saying that this is your best life now and everything's going to be great and good when you come to the Lord. I don't feel comfortable even in my own personal life with Christians that I know, people in my church. You go and ask them how they're doing, they're always doing good, they're feeling great, they have a smile on their face. And it is true, we should rejoice in the Lord and have hope and joy and contentment and satisfaction in the Lord. But life is painful. And I like to be with people that are willing to share their suffering with me as iron sharpens iron. And we carry each other's burdens, as Galatians chapter 6, verse 2 tells us. Carry the burdens of others so as to fulfill the law of Christ. And in this life, we are going to have many burdens. Job 14, verse 1 tells us, "Man born of a woman is a few years and many troubles." Psalm 34, verses 18 and 19 tells us that God is close to the brokenhearted, many of the afflictions of the righteous, but God will deliver them from them from them all. We are going to suffer. Matter of fact, it says in Philippians, if you could read this for yourself, Philippians chapter 1, verse 29 tells us, the Apostle Paul, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, said that it's granted unto you not only to believe and have faith in Jesus Christ, but to suffer for his name's sake. We are going to suffer one way or another. In the book of Revelation chapter 2, verse 10, when the Lord is speaking to the church of Smyrna, which is a representation of the church age, all seven churches, and he says in Revelation chapter 2, verse 10, that many will be thrown into prison. I have a study Bible in my house, which has the notes of the Voice of the Martyrs. It is a ministry from Richard Wurmbrand, basically tells of the persecution of the Christian church going on today. And I could tell you from the notes that I read and the reports that I see, many Christians are suffering immensely for their faith in Christ. Here in America, we've been so blessed by God. But those freedoms are eroding, and we're going to have to count the cost of what it really means to follow Christ as persecution comes more and more to the Western world. But we are going to suffer. But suffering, Romans chapter 5, verses 1 to 5, read that passage of Scripture when you have time. It speaks about having faith in Christ, the peace with God. But as you go on in that passage of Scripture, it speaks about having contentment and peace through affliction. The Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 12, verse 12, tells us that we are to be patient in affliction, joyful in hope, fervent in prayer. James speaks of this in James chapter 1, verses 2 to 4, where it speaks about our affliction and pain and suffering in life will produce patience. It produces spiritual fruit in our lives. And James will go on in a few more verses later in James chapter 1, verse 12, that when we do suffer in this world, it will produce what's called the crown of life. My friends, suffering is as natural as breathing on this earth. And no one knew this more than our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. No one needs to read any further than Isaiah chapter 53, which is a prophecy of the coming Messiah, Jesus Christ. And he would be a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. He would suffer much. I mean, you look at the life of Christ, who's our example. He was born in a manger because there was no room for him in the inn. He had to be shuffled down to Egypt when he was 2 years old because Herod was killing all the babies. He was brought up in an obscure village of Nazareth, worked in a carpenter shop, probably with his stepfather, Joseph, got into his public ministry for 3 years, proclaiming the good news of salvation found in himself by God's grace. And how was he treated? His own family thought he was crazy. He had 12 disciples. When he needed them most, they abandoned him. It is said in the scriptures that he had nowhere to lay his head. You know, the birds and the foxes in the fields had places of shelter, but the Son of Man had nowhere to lay his head. He suffered on a cross, the most cruel kind of death that anyone can endure. And he was even buried in a rented tomb. Couldn't even have his own tomb. It had to be somebody else's tomb. What I'm saying is that the life of Christ was a life of suffering here on this earth. But yet it produced obedience to the Lord more and more. I found in my life that we learn, and you can read this in Hebrews chapter 5, verses 7 to 9. Christ learned obedience by the things that he suffered. And we too will learn to obey God more when we're in the valley. You see, when we're on the mountaintop, things are going good. You get lazy, you get complacent, we get comfortable. We get fattened for the slaughter, so to speak. But when we're in the crucible of pain and suffering, my friends, that's when we really turn to the Lord more and more. Heavenly Father, Lord God, I thank you for my brothers and sisters in Christ who will see this devotional video today. May they be strong in affliction, joyful in hope, and fervent in prayer. In Jesus' name I pray. God bless.